Thank you for coming. My name is Martin. I work for Cake Solutions, a software services company, working with Scala, distributed systems, machine learning, and big data. And today I'll talk about data in motion, about streaming static data efficiently. I'll focus on Akka persistence, but I will also explain how some of these concepts apply to general distributed computing and other systems that you might want to build. Just to introduce the topic, we want to build reactive applications, applications that can handle large-scale data, and they want to, they need to be elastic and scalable, resilient, and handle failures. But the most important part from this presentation's perspective is the ability to handle asynchronous messages. So we don't want to run our business analytics pipeline every hour or every day. We want our views to be updated immediately as new data arrive. Similarly with users looking at UI, we don't want to send requests and receive response when the user asks. We want the view to be updated immediately as new data is available. One of the ways we can achieve this is using streams. So stream is a continuous sequence of data sent from a publisher to subscriber. And the subscriber essentially subscribes to the data, and then they're always kept up to date. They don't have to ask for more data. They are kept up to date by the publishers. We can define graphs like these with operations like maps and filters and join streams and broadcast streams. And also the arrows going the other way, they can be things like acknowledgments for reliable delivery or for back pressure. And there are many use cases for streaming data, from financial transactions, Internet of Things, or training and applying machine learning models. So many use cases. And importantly, you don't have to use tools like Apache Spark for distributed stream processing. You can also use tools like Akka or Akka Streams, or even any programming language. The concepts are the same. You just may need to build a bit more yourself. We'll talk most today about Akka persistence, so I'm assuming most of you are familiar with Akka. Akka is an actor framework on the JVM. It gives us very nice properties using the actor model. So things like isolation, asynchronous messaging between actors, or supervision, and it allows us to build services and truly distributed systems just using this programming model. In this case, we have multiple physical machines, and each of the machines, they're using Akka sharding. So each of the machines has a subset of the domain of actors. And we send a message to the cluster. It is automatically delivered by Akka to the correct physical machine and correct actor. And the actor can react to that message. So it can send other messages to other actors. It can change its internal state. But the state is only in memory. So if the actor fails, or if the node fails, which is a common scenario, especially in distributed systems, we would lose all that state. So we want to use Akka persistence. It provides an event sourced journal of events. So every time a message is received, we store an event at the end of this journal. And then if the actor fails, it can replay the messages in the journal and reconstruct the previous state. So it gives us resiliency in case of failure or rebalancing or other scenarios. This is how it looks like in code. So we extend persistent actor, and then we have to implement a couple of methods. First one is persistence ID, which is a unique ID identifying this actor in the cluster or in the system. And then we need to define a method called receive command that specifies how we handle commands, the messages that arrive to that actor. So in this case, we handle update balance command, and when this command arrives, we validate it first. And then if it passes the validation, we persist it. And persisting it is essentially a checkpoint. So we store it at the end of the event sourced log, at the end of the journal. And from now on, we know that if the actor fails, it will always have that message. And then we perform some actions as a reaction to that message. So we respond to some actors, we change our internal state, or do whatever we need to do with it. There's another concept called tagging. So we can tag the message when storing it by wrapping it in the tagged case class. And then we can assign a couple of tags to this message. In this case, we just assign tag one. And I will explain later why this is important. It's used for aggregations in Akka persistence. And then when the actor fails, it will restart somewhere else in the cluster, potentially on the same machine or different machine, but it will replay all the messages that are already in the journal. And it will apply some changes to the internal state and reconstruct the state, therefore recover from the failure in the same state where it was before. It uses an event source journal, as I mentioned, and it's essentially a log data structure. And log data structure is extremely simple, but it's very, very useful data structure. We always only append new events at the end of the log, so we never change or delete records. And it has other useful properties, such as it defines a single order of operations. So every time we read the log, it will always have the same order. Also, we only need a single number and offset, and we can, just using this single number, we know where we are in this log structure. It's used in many places where durability and fault tolerance is required. A good example is a write-ahead log in database. So the database writes into a write-ahead log, then performs a transaction, and if the transaction fails, it will reconcile what's in the database and in the write-ahead log and therefore recover from the failure. Other good use cases are in log replication during distributed consensus and other applications where these attributes are important. So today we'll talk about the implementation of Akka persistence in Apache Cassandra database. I'm not sure if you're familiar with Cassandra, so I'll just briefly explain the data model. This is how the data are stored. The event source journal is stored in Cassandra database. Cassandra is a highly scalable and available database, a distributed database. It uses concepts such as sharding and replication to hold its data. And the main concept is called a partition. A partition is this. A partition lives on a single physical machine, and it has multiple rows. We will not represent rows as rows here because we're not interested for the purpose of this presentation in what's in the row. So we'll only represent them as events. We're only interested in the sequence numbers, so event 0, 1, 2, etc. The partition lives on a single physical machine, and we need to reference it using a partitioning key. In our case, it's a tuple persistence ID partition number. So if we know both of these, we can find this partition in the cluster. For a single actor, we can have multiple partitions because Cassandra is most efficient if we have certain size of partition. And when it reaches certain size, we just need to create another partition. So we increase the partition number while the persistence ID stays the same. And then finding a single event in a single partition is a very efficient operation in Cassandra. But scanning multiple partitions, because they live on different places in the whole cluster, is very incredibly inefficient. So we never want to do that. And we will talk mostly today about Akka Persistence Query. That's the read side of CQRS. So the write side is storing the events in this event source journal, and then we want to read the data as well. So we'll talk about Akka Persistence Query, which gives us a way to read the data from the event source journal, and essentially it uses streaming. So we subscribe to a stream, and then every time an actor stores a new event into this event source journal, the stream will immediately be updated, so the subscriber will immediately see that change. There are multiple streams available at the moment. The first one, the simplest one, is events by persistence ID. We can get it by creating the Cassandra read journal, and we get it by using the persistence query extension, and then we ask for Cassandra read journal. And then we simply call events by persistence ID, and this will give us a stream of all events for a single actor in the correct order. So the result may look something like this. We have all events for that single persistence ID, and they are ordered by their sequence number. Another stream that is available is called all persistence IDs. All persistence IDs gives us a stream of names of all actors in the system. So if a new actor is created, it will again be emitted into the stream. And if we are subscribed, we'll see all these changes. And the last one is called events by tag. So I previously talked about the tagged case class, and you can assign a tag to each event. And here, when we subscribe to a tag, then we will see all messages that have this tag assigned. That's very useful, especially for things like aggregations, because events for multiple actors, they're not related in any way. But by assigning a tag, we actually link them together, and therefore we are able to do things like aggregations across multiple actors. And it creates an Akka stream. So we can integrate it with any other Akka stream applications. We can, for example, do things like collect, so choose the events we're interested in, or scan, which where we introduce some sort of state. And we just use this circular queue, so we essentially have a sliding window of last five elements in the stream. And we can also use the Akka Streams graph API. So we create a graph of events by persistence ID. So we subscribe to the stream, then send it through the transformation that creates a sliding window of last five elements in the stream, and send it to, for example, to Kafka. So we can do whatever Akka Streams allow us to do. There's another interesting use case, and that's in Lagom, which is Lightbend's latest product. In Lagom, there's a concept of persistent entity. And persistent entity is very similar to persistent actor, as we described it before. So I'll not spend too much time describing it. But essentially, you again define how you handle commands, then how you handle events. So it's very similar to the event-sourced persistent actor. But the interesting thing I wanted to show is on the read side. So this is Cassandra read side processor. And it's on the read side, and it uses events by tag query. So you subscribe to a tag that you're interested in this case, it's tag one. So we're interested in tag one. And every time the stream produces new event with this particular tag, we will be updated. And this view will always, in single thread, receive all the events with tag one. And it can construct a database writes or database queries. And the way this is usually is used is that you prepare other database writes, and you write the data into different database in different formats, something that you can then query easily in your application. You can query it efficiently. So you just create a different view of the data. And the view will always be kept up to date. So every time a new event with the tag is persisted, your view will immediately be updated with that latest event. So I participated in the implementation. Most credit goes to Patrick Nordwall and Martin Kresser, but I also had the opportunity to help. So I'll talk about the internals and how the stream is actually created from Apache Cassandra. We're turning a database into a stream of data. And there's an interesting relationship between databases and streams. Essentially, a mutable table can be a state of a stream in point in time, and the log data structure, which is our case, is essentially a stream and can be turned into a stream very easily. Because we just read it row by row and produce those rows into a stream. And when a new row is added at the end of the log, it's always appended at the end. So we know it was added. So we, again, emit it very easily into the stream. And the good property of that is that we can multiple times materialize the same stream, and the result will always have the same order, and it will always be the same stream. So turning a log data structure into a stream is actually very simple and very straightforward. So we implemented this generic actor publisher, which is an actor that integrates with Akka streams, and it essentially reads Cassandra partition or multiple partitions and turn them into a stream, emit them into a stream. It's pretty generic. The implementing classes just have to implement a couple of methods. So define what the initial state is, how to query the data, how to update its internal state, and a couple other methods. And actor is actually a very good abstraction to work in this environment because it's completely asynchronous, and it gives us nice ways how to handle asynchrony. A good example is the pipe to method. So if we do a non-blocking asynchronous query to database, we'll receive a future. And we can do the pipe to self, and therefore when the future completes, it will send a message to this actor, and this actor will then handle it as if it was any other message. It just goes to the mailbox. Which might then seem quite simple, but it can be quite complicated because we're still in completely asynchronous environment. So there may be a lot of events happening completely asynchronously. A good example are things like requests for more data from downstream components. Akka streams use back pressure, so the downstream components, when they're idle, they will ask for more data, and this actor has to handle that. It also has to handle asynchronous queries to database, so fetches from the same partition, from the next partition. It has to manage its buffer efficiently. And also, because we're reading from a database, we're sometimes, at some point, we will reach the end of the log. And then we need to re-query the database after certain periods of time to see if any new data appeared. So there's a lot going on completely asynchronously, so that the state transition diagram will look something like this. We start in initial state, and then depending, we do initial query, non-blocking query to database, and then depending on what's going on, we actually need to react to all these completely asynchronous events. Good, so let's have a look at some of the implementations of this generic actor publisher. The first one is events by persistence ID. That's the simplest one. It gives us events for a single persistence ID in the correct order. This is how the data are physically stored in Cassandra. And actually, the query is exactly what we need in this instance, because we specify both parts of the partitioning key, and we specify a range of sequence numbers. So the query will very simply give us event by event in the correct order, and very, very efficiently, because we will just go through a single partition on a couple of partitions. So that's exactly what Cassandra does well. And the code, the important method is how we update the state. And the code is actually very simple and very efficient, because we're reading from a log. So we just really need to remember a single number, which is the sequence number. And then it increases by one every time we read a new event. And we need to remember the partition number. So the code is very efficient and very simple. The other query, all persistence IDs, is a bit more difficult. The query may still look reasonable, so like distinct persistence ID partition number. However, in Cassandra, when doing distinct, we need to specify both parts of the partitioning key, which is not ideal, because that will give us a tuple 00, so we emit 0 as the new actor name available. But it will also give us 01, but we have already emitted 0, and we don't want to have duplicates. So we need to maintain some state that will remove those duplicates. And then the last one, it will give us 10, and we emit 1. The problem is that Cassandra partitions are completely independent. So if a new actor is created, new actor is persistent event, it can be anywhere in the cluster. So we don't have any ordering at all. So what we need to do is we need to maintain a state, a set of all persistence IDs that we have already emitted. And then we need to query the database again and compare the result from the database with the set of already emitted persistence IDs and only emit those that are new, which is incredibly inefficient, especially because the set can grow infinitely. It's an infinite stream, so the set can grow infinitely. So that's something that we don't want to do ideally. And the most complicated query is events by tag. So this is how the data are currently stored in the database, and some of the events for different actors are tagged by tag 1. And we only want to emit those with tag 1 into the stream. With this original data structure, the only way to do that would be by actually reading all events in all partitions, so doing a full table scan of all events in all partitions, and only emitting those that have tag 1 assigned to them. And that's incredibly inefficient. It's something that we definitely don't want to do every time we read this stream from a database. So the way this is usually handled is by splitting the data to write side and the read side. So this is how the data are written into database, and we create a different view of the data. We repartition the data to be able to query it more efficiently. So we repartition it by tag, and then we can very efficiently go through a single or a couple of partitions very efficiently because we have this nice view of the data. And before I proceed, I want to very briefly explain some concepts about consistency in distributed environment. So most people using relational databases are used to linearizability, serializability, or some strong consistency guarantees. But we're in distributed environment, and those guarantees are extremely expensive. So we will talk about much weaker consistency levels. The first one is eventual consistency. That means that the replicas will eventually be consistent. We also talk about read your own writes consistency. That means that when a process writes some data, and then reads the same data again, it will always see the data it has written. And we'll also talk about causal consistency. That simply says that events that are causally dependent on each other will have some order defined. So not all events will have order, but only events that are causally dependent, such as one was a result of the previous one. They will, all processes will always see them in the correct order. There are some issues with this implementation. So we're using Cassandra 3 implementation of materialized views. So Cassandra automatically keeps this materialized view for us updated. There are a few issues. First one is that we partition it by tag, but then we need to sub-partition it, otherwise the partition would just grow way too large. And the only way to do this, because we don't have any more control, is by defining a time bucket. It can be a day, it can be a month, or a year, but in some day we can have many events, but other day we may not have too many, just a couple. So it may be very inefficient. Some partitions may be really large, some of them may be really small. So that's something that we would like to avoid. And also, the biggest issue is that Cassandra replicates data from the original structure to the view in parallel. So that may not sound like an issue, but Cassandra assumes that partitions are independent of each other, because usually they are. But in our case, events in a single partition are dependent. They have causal consistency. They have causality between them, because the sequence number increases monotonically by one with each event. And also, multiple partitions for the same actor are ordered. So this partition only comes after the first one. However, Cassandra does not honor that. So when it replicates to the view, it can actually replicate the second partition before the first one. And also, if we do multiple writes into the same partition, one write may go to a single node in the cluster, and different write may go to a different node in the cluster. But the later write may actually be replicated first. So we would receive, during reads, we would receive the later write first, and the monotonically increasing sequence number would not be maintained. The problem is this cannot be handled on the read side. So imagine we first read event 1 for ID 0, and then the next one we read is event 100 for ID 0. But we don't know if this is the next one, because there may be other tagged in between them. So we can wait for a period of time, and they will eventually be there. But we don't know how long we need to wait. So the way this is currently implemented is we wait for a period of time for eventual consistency delay, which is by default 10 seconds. But it's still not correct. It's still not deterministic. Because you may wait for 10 seconds, but Cassandra did not replicate the data in 10 seconds. It may, for some reason, probably because of network partition, or for some reason, it may not replicated within those 10 seconds, so we may still get inconsistent data. This may not be an issue for many applications that don't need the causal consistency, but it may be an issue for those that they do need it. Another concept, important concept, is in Akka persistence is replay. So in replay, we replay all the messages for a single actor to recover its state from after a failure. This is the original implementation. It used blocking calls wrapped in a future, which is not ideal because it blocks some threads. And it also views this notion of iterators. They're not really the nicest functional code. They use a lot of vars and nulls, although it was single-threaded and actually pretty efficient on a single thread. But the biggest issue was this row iterator. It was using a lot of blocking calls. This uses a Cassandra Java driver, and the session.execute is actually a blocking call to a database, which is something that we probably don't want to do. And there's a bit more subtle hidden issue, which is calling the iterator.next. In Cassandra Java driver, when you create an iterator, it will do a blocking call to database and retrieve a buffer of data. And then every time you call iterator.next, it will give you a next element from that buffer, which is all right, but at some point, you will exhaust that buffer. So it needs to perform another blocking call to database, which is something that you would ideally want to avoid. But now we have Akka Persistence Query. So with Akka Persistence Query, we can actually just use, queries events by persistence ID. And events by persistence ID is a stream of all events for a single actor. So that's exactly what we need for replay. So if we set the consistency levels correctly, so the reads and writes at least to quorum, it will give us the stream of all events with the consistency that we need. And the code simplifies a lot, and it will actually be completely non-blocking. It will never block a thread during database calls. This new implementation is actually quite efficient. It's slower on a single thread, but it utilizes its resources a bit better. So in most use cases, it actually outperforms the original single-threaded blocking implementation. If you want, and I'm pretty sure you want, your replays when after failures to be efficient, definitely have a look at the thread pool or the dispatcher available to it. So have a look at it and definitely tune the number of threads and the dispatcher that's available to the replay. And another things to look at are definitely the result size, so and the size of the partition and the size of the buffer, because you want to limit the number of calls to database, but at the same time you don't want to do too large calls, otherwise that would consume a lot of memory. So you need to find the sweet spot where your application actually performs the best. During the implementation, we also talked about this alternative architecture. So this alternative architecture was never implemented, but we're actually considering it for the implementation of Akka Persistence for Kafka. The alternative architecture is very nice because it's not dependent on Cassandra 3 implementation of materialized views. And it gives us all the guarantees that we need for Akka Persistence. And I'll talk about it because it nicely explains or uses some of the concepts known in streaming and in distributed systems. So I'll explain some of those and explain how they're important. Sorry. So the first part of this architecture is essentially a write-ahead log on each physical node. So every time an actor persists an event, we will immediately write it into a write-ahead log on the physical machine. So one of these partitions will contain multiple events from multiple actors, and similarly, because actor can move from node to node, one actor's events will live in multiple of these physical partitions. We then merge all these physical partitions into a stream of all events. So we create a single stream of all events in the system, and we create an order. We just need to maintain causality per persistence ID. That's all we need to maintain, and we create a single order. And then the last step in this pipeline is to create those materialized views. The first one is exactly the same as the original data structure, as events by persistence ID. So we again have persistence ID, partition number, and the events for that particular actor. But for events by tag, we now can maintain the causality, and also we can subpartition the data more efficiently with more granularity. Previously, we had to use those time buckets, but this time we can actually maintain it as much as we want, as closely as we want. Similarly, or persistence IDs. If you remember, we had to maintain a potentially infinitely large set of all already emitted persistence IDs, but now we don't have to because we can maintain any state, we can replay the previous stream as many times as we want, so we can actually create very efficient view even for all persistence IDs. So at this point you might be wondering, why would we go through this whole pipeline? Why wouldn't we simply, when an actor writes an event, why wouldn't we in transaction write into all these materialized views that we can then efficiently query? That would work very well in a relational database because you have strong consistency guarantees. But in Cassandra and other distributed databases, you don't have those guarantees. If we wrote in a batch into database into all these three views, Cassandra batches, they provide atomicity, but they don't have isolation. Therefore, the batch, all the statements in the batch either succeed or fail together, but they are only eventually consistent. But we need stronger form of consistency. We need to read your own writes consistency. Otherwise, imagine you have an actor that persists some events into its event source journal, then dies and recovers, and only replaces some of the events it has written, not all of them. So therefore, it recovers in an inconsistent state, and that's something that you never want to experience. So you might argue that, okay, so we can write into a single partition, because writes into single partition in Cassandra provide both atomicity and isolation, and then create a different batch and write all the other views, because they don't need read your own write consistency. However, now we're doing two completely independent statements, and in a distributed environment, everything can fail completely asynchronously. So it could happen that one of these was executed and completed, but the other statement wasn't. So we can again end up having two inconsistent views. So I'll talk about some of the concepts important for, in stream processing. The first one is event time processing. Most stream processing systems, such as Spark and others, only use processing time. Processing time is the time the event is actually being processed in the processing system. But we want to use, sometimes we want to use event time. Event time is the time the event was actually created, or a business time associated with that event. They're not the same, because the event may be delayed for a period of time during the processing pipeline or traveling across network. So they're not the same. In this particular example, the blue events were created at around the same time. So we would want to process them in the blue window, process them in the same window. However, one of them was delayed for a period of time, so it will not fit in the blue window. This is using processing time windowing. But using we can use event time windowing and wait for a period of time and capture all the blue events in the blue window. That's not non-trivial, and it usually has two issues associated to that. First one is buffering. So we need to keep the window open for a period of time, so we need some internal memory. And we also, the other is completeness. So we don't know, generally we don't know when we can close the window. Because we can wait for a period of time and capture this one, but how do we know there are other events later in the stream that will arrive later? So we don't know, generally, how long we need to keep that window open. This is usually handled, for example, in Google's data flow by using watermarks, triggers, or heuristics. But we will see a simpler solution for our particular use case. Another concept in distributed system, a very common one, is ordering. So you usually, in distributed system, don't have a global clock that all processes would have atomic access to. So how streaming processing systems usually handle this is they read just using a single thread. So they sacrifice parallelism and read with a single thread that creates a total order of operations. Another option how to handle this is, for example, Apache Spark's Cassandra connector. It knows that Cassandra's partitions are completely independent, so it can read them in parallel and create multiple completely independent streams. And the reason I'm talking about these concepts is we have these physical streams in the first part of our pipeline, and we're merging them into this stream of all events. But we need to maintain causality per persistence ID. That's our requirement. So we're merging them in parallel, and it can easily happen that first we merge event 0 for ID 0, but the next one we encounter is event 2 for ID 0. That's not the expected ID, so we cannot merge this event immediately, and we need to maintain some sort of buffer that tells us which sequence number is the next one. And we can progress the pointer or the buffer only if we encounter the next sequence, the next expected sequence number. So we need to maintain the buffer. It's similar to event time processing. It's not the same concept, but very similar. And the completeness in our case is much simpler. In the general case, we did not know how long we needed to wait. But in this case, we know exactly how long we need to wait because the sequence number is monotonically increasing. So we're just looking for the next available or the next needed sequence number. Another important concept is replay. So we have discussed previously that for a replay, we need read your own writes consistency. But in this pipeline, we only have eventual consistency. So we cannot simply just emit events that are already in the materialized view because they're only eventually consistent. So we also need to finish the replay by actually reading events that are still in this stream and events that are still in this stream and were not yet processed and moved further in the pipeline. And therefore, we increase the consistency from eventual consistency to read your own writes consistency. This might seem a bit too heavy for this implementation, but other frameworks, such as Eventuate, they actually do exactly this when reading from. Another concept common in distributed systems, commonly encountered, is exactly once delivery. So assume we have a publisher and a subscriber, and the publisher is sending messages to the subscriber. across unreliable, completely unreliable network. So any of the messages may be lost at any point in time, and they may not be delivered to the subscriber. How this is usually handled is by sending acknowledgments back to the publisher. But even the acknowledgments may be lost, any of them may be lost during the sending across unreliable network. And even worse, both the publisher and subscriber can die at any time completely asynchronously. So in this completely hostile environment, how do we actually make sure that messages are delivered from the publisher to subscriber? The general way to handle this is by having durability on both sides of the pipeline. So we need durability in the publisher so it can resend messages that were not delivered, and we need durability in the subscriber because then it may receive some messages twice and it needs to be able to reliably deduplicate those that it has seen before. And it needs to handle this thing even after failing for an unbounded period of time. So it's not trivial, but it's definitely achievable. Some frameworks, such as Apache Spark, they use replication of the stream. They write into a write-ahead log to be able to replay the data, and they use RDDs to gain reliability. Apache Flink, for example, uses a distributed snapshotting algorithm for exactly once delivery, and others do similar things. Storm and others send acknowledgments for each of the messages it received. So this needs to be handled in a distributed environment. But our case, when we are merging the streams and processing the streams in Akka Persistence in the alternative architecture, is actually much simpler because we already have those streams stored in Cassandra database. So we simply just progress the pointer every time we read a new message and we know it's been processed and moved into the next stage. We just simply progress the pointer. And if there's a failure, we just have durably stored this offset, or we can actually reconstruct the offset by reading the database. So our case is, again, much, much simpler. So the whole architecture would look something like this, and it would not only make us independent on Cassandra 3 implementation of materialized views, but it would also give us all the guarantees that we need. So exactly once delivery, the consistency guarantees that we need, so read your own write consistency for replay, and also very efficient reads from these materialized views. So we can now create the streams, Akka Persistence Query streams, very, very efficiently. There's another project used for reading events from Akka Persistence database, and that's called Akka Analytics. So it's another Martin Krasser's project, and it uses actually Apache Spark to read the events from Cassandra. Apache Spark Cassandra connector is pretty efficient, so it actually reads all events from all database tables, events from all actors. So it actually does a full table scan, but it does it completely in parallel. So it's actually quite efficient. And in this case, then you can use Spark's API. So in this case, we simply just pick event types that we're interested in, and then we use reduce by, which is a distributed reduce, and then we just pick the top 100 actors that have the highest balance on their account from the whole domain of all actors in our system. So the concepts I talked about are commonly used in other use cases. A good one is this. It's called streaming data architecture or Kappa architecture. It was introduced by Jay Krebs or the Confluent by some time ago, and it actually it uses something that can handle large-scale streams, such as Apache Kafka in the middle, and then anyone can publish a stream into Apache Kafka. So it can be any devices, social media, any services, anyone can publish a stream. And then we have something that can handle exactly once delivery, exactly once processing of these streams, and then anyone who's interested can actually read from any of those streams. So on the other side, we have analytics, we have search engines, we have different database tables, and they're always kept up to date. So they will always receive the newest messages. They just subscribe to a stream. They don't query the database, they just subscribe, and they will always be kept up to date with the latest data. And if we use the concepts that we talked about, we can actually achieve things like exactly once delivery, fault tolerance, and we can scale any of these services completely independently on each other. They're all distributed systems. They can all handle failures, and they can all be scaled completely independently. Another typical example are just general distributed systems. So assume we have different microservices. One can use a CQRS event sourcing. One can use relational database. So they have their own consistency within their context. But they need to communicate with each other. So they usually send messages to each other. But ideally, again, we would not want that to be a request response, because that can fail, and then usually a user has to deal with that. We would ideally want that to be asynchronous messaging that we can look at as streams. So we can, again, build the same guarantees, such as exactly once delivery, fault tolerance. We can scale any of these services completely independently, and they will always make sure that the message they want to tell the other system will eventually be delivered. And we can even build stronger consistency guarantees if we need to, as we have seen before. So you might argue that this is actually not the greatest example of a microservice architecture, and it actually isn't, because it's an example of Google's TensorFlow, of asynchronous data and model parallelism in TensorFlow. So if you're not familiar with TensorFlow, it's Google's machine learning and large-scale data processing framework. It has this concept of devices, and a device can be things like a GPU, CPU, or other processing unit, and they can be in distributed environment on multiple machines. And then in TensorFlow, you define the computation as a data flow graph, and then TensorFlow assigns this data flow graph to each of these devices, and then they compute in distributed system, they compute the directed acyclic graph that you defined. There are some differences from typical distributed systems, such as consistency sometimes is not as critical, because some machine learning algorithms can handle certain types of inconsistencies. And also, it has to assign some computations to GPUs, because they're then more efficient and things like that. But they, at the same time, they need to handle some of these exactly the same concepts. They don't use Scala or Akka streams, but they use gRPC, they use whatever language, but they need exactly the same guarantees. If one of the devices sends a message to another device on a different machine, they need to make sure that the message is delivered, and they need to be delivered in certain order. And they, if one of the devices or one of the machines fails, they need to be able to handle that and either rerun the computation somewhere else or somehow handle it. So they use exactly the same concept. So it's not Akka specific. Other companies use that as well, just using different technologies. So that might actually sound really nice. So why don't we build it? There are certain challenges associated to actually doing this in your application. Some of the common ones are, so building exactly once delivery, achieving the exact consistency guarantees that you need, achieving availability, achieving fault tolerance. Cross-service invariants and therefore distributed transactions across services are a difficult thing. Automated deployment, serialization, versioning, automated elasticity, no downtime version updates, graceful shutdown of nodes, distributed system verification, split brain scenarios, and all these things happen in distributed systems, but they're all solved problems. So if you know how to handle them, you can handle them correctly, and you can actually achieve the guarantees that your system needs. So in conclusion, we moved from request response architecture, from synchronous messaging and mutable state, we moved to a land of streams and asynchronous messaging. But most importantly, we're building production-ready distributed systems. So distributed system has to be handled as a first-class citizen. You must expect things like failures, lost messages, asynchronous failures, and all these things. But if you do it correctly, you can actually achieve the guarantees that your system needs. Thank you very much. Any questions?
Is Cassandra the only option for Akka persistence, or are there also other databases that can be used? I see that Cassandra is the best option, but is there other options for Akka?
Yeah, thanks. Good question. So the question was if there are other options for Akka Persistence other than Cassandra. There are. You currently can use the local file system, you can use LevelDB, or you can use Cassandra. There's also an experimenter module for Kafka, but that will still need to be updated. But Cassandra, in production systems, Cassandra is currently the only option.
In Akka Streams, a flow graph, as far as I know, is just running in one JVM process. Yeah, so it's on one machine. So if you want to distribute it, you don't distribute the same flow graph over several machines. So you can replicate it and run it several times. That's not the problem. But if it's one flow graph and you want, so see, I want the one operation processed on this machine and from the same graph, process the other operation and the other machine, maybe Akka Streams is not the right tool and you have to switch to Spark. Yeah, can you say something about that?
Yeah, definitely. So currently Akka Streams cannot be distributed across multiple machines. I think Lightbend is working on implementation. Also, there's a project by Intel called Gearpump that claims to be able to execute Akka Streams. They provide a materializer that actually distributes the computation. But yes, if you need that, you may need to use things like Apache Spark, Apache Flink, Apex, or Storm, or other distributed processing framework. Okay, thank you.